Okay, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Center for Middle East Studies, I'd like to welcome everyone to our final event of this academic year. We're going out with a bang by having Ussama Makdisi, one of the preeminent scholars and historians of the Middle East, here to address one of the most important, vexing, and topical questions facing the Middle East today, understanding sectarianism, the history and future of the Middle East's Gordian knot, is the official title for today's presentation. Ussama Makdisi obtained his doctorate from the Department of History at Princeton University, and he's now a professor of history and the first holder of the Arab American Educational Foundation Chair of Arab Studies at Rice University in Houston. In 2009, Professor Makdisi was named a Carnegie Scholar for his contributions to enriching this country's discourse on the Arab-Islamic world. In 2012-2013, he was a resident fellow at the Institute of Advanced Study in Berlin. And Professor Rashid Khalidi at Columbia has called Ussama Makdisi, quote, one of the premier historians of the modern Arab world and of the Arab-American encounter. He is the author of three important works, The Culture of Sectarianism, Community History and Violence in 19th-Century Ottoman Lebanon, which Beirut's Daily Star called a nuanced critique of historical reductionism, scapegoats, and easy, simple explanations. His second book, Artillery of Heaven, American Missionaries and the Failed Conversion of the Middle East, which the Middle East Journal described or said presents a model of a new kind of transnational history that sheds light on the American engagement with the world. This book, Artillery of Heaven, won the prestigious Albert Hourani Book Award from the Middle East Studies Association. It also won the John Hope Franklin Prize from the American Studies Association. And his third book, Faith Misplaced, The Broken Promises of U.S.-Arab Relations, 1820 to 2001, which the Publishers Weekly said, quote, efficiently debunks the Huntingtonian belief in an inevitable clash of civilizations and resurrects a forgotten history of mutual curiosity and cultural cross-pollination between the East and the West. Professor Makdisi is also the co-editor of Memory and Violence in the Middle East and North Africa, and he's now working on a book on the origins of sectarianism in the modern Middle East. We're also very pleased to announce that Professor Makdisi will be contributing a chapter to our center's forthcoming book on sectarianism. In many ways, we hope it will be the penultimate sort of chapter that grounds the study of contemporary sectarianism and sectarianization within a historic context. It's a huge honor to have him with us today. Please join me in welcoming to the University of Denver, Ussama Makdisi.
Thank you, Professor Hashimi, and thank you, Professor Postel, and thank you to the Center for Middle East Studies for hosting me here today, and thank you, of course, all for showing up for this lecture on the question of understanding sectarianism in the modern Middle East. It seems pretty obvious to me, and I'm sure to you, that there is an urgent crisis. Can you hear me in the back? Yeah, that there's an urgent crisis in the Middle East today, a crisis that is often characterized as a sectarian crisis, and a crisis in which every carefully choreographed act of ISIS or Islamic State cruelty that we hear so much about in the media today presents not only an obscene vision of what religion allegedly is, it also, these acts, they also lash out against an extraordinary history, a very rich history of pluralism that ISIS and its fellow travelers in the region appear intent upon obscuring, effacing, and denying. So from the outset today, let me say two things to sort of explain my basic premise in this lecture. First, I do not accept romantic notions of coexistence, age-old coexistence. I do believe in a history of pluralism and a history of coexistence, but not in a romantic interpretation of that, an uncritical interpretation of that. Second, and probably more important for our lecture this evening or this afternoon, is I do not accept at all ahistorical notions of a deep, medieval Oriental religiosity or sectarianism that allegedly haunts the contemporary or modern Middle East. Such notions are the essence, it seems to me, of extraordinarily lazy journalism and scholarship. To make the point in the simplest terms, the geopolitical context of today is not the same as that of a century ago, let alone of a millennium ago. The great Sigmund Freud, in fact, wrote in Civilization and Its Discontents about what he described as the narcissism of minor differences, that in any society could turn into something far more dangerous, namely group hatred. Freud's point was that every society, every modern civilized society, carries within it the possibility of turning on its constituent parts. Civilized society, Freud wrote, is perpetually threatened with disintegration, end quote. The modern Arab world is no exception. Yet mainstream Western journalism about the Arab world routinely informs us that Sunnis and Shiites today in the Arab world are replaying, allegedly, an original schism from Islam that dates back over 1,200, 1,300 years. Take the BBC correspondent, Jeremy Bowen, who informs us solemnly 2 years ago that, quote, the weight of a millennium and a half of sectarian rivalry is crushing hopes of a better future, end quote. And this kind of pronouncement is often made both in the UK and the US media. Bowen describes Saddam Hussein in the same article as, quote, a Sunni strongman who fought against Shia Iran, end quote. But what does this phrase, a Sunni strongman, actually mean? Let's think about that. Saddam Hussein, of course, was also Tikriti, Baathi, Iraqi, and Arab. He collaborated at different points in his rulership of Iraq and his dictatorship over Iraq with the United States, with the Soviet Union, with the Shah's Iran, and with Saudi Arabia. Saddam Hussein, after all, also killed Sunni Arabs and Kurds and communists and anyone who threatened his rule. He also invaded Sunni Kuwait, all inconvenient facts that complicate Bowen's absurdly one-dimensional and highly misleading sectarian narrative. And what I say about Bowen, you could say about just about any other journalist who also talks about age-old Sunni-Shiite rivalries. Think indeed of how Western journalism such as Bowen's and Western scholarship routinely identify individuals from the region as being either Sunni or Shiite or Christian, although these individuals almost never openly identify themselves as such. Whereas the same journalism refuses, understandably, to begin every description of Barack Obama as the African-American president, or as the black president, or Hillary Clinton as the white Clinton, despite, for example, the rioting that's been taking place in the US over the past year, in Ferguson, Missouri, and in Baltimore today. I do not, of course, deny the salience of sectarian affiliations in the Middle East, but far too often it seems to me we allow a word, Sunni, Shi'i, to take the place of coherent, historically grounded arguments, as if being Sunni or Shi'i is self-evident, as if it precludes other forms of identification, as if being Sunni or Shi'i is a singular identity. The reality is that like the word fanaticism, like the word barbarism, like the word terrorism, analytically speaking, there is no such thing as a transhistorical sectarianism with a capital S. There are instead specific, and I admit, sometimes horrifying episodes that come about, sectarian episodes that come about for a number of interrelated ideological, political, economic, and cultural factors. I do not, in other words, see sectarianism as a stable, obvious, ever-present social reality that floats above history. For this very reason, I do not see my task this afternoon to try and explain each and every sectarian event in the Middle East as if there is such a thing as an endlessly repeating story of sectarianism. There is no such thing. So what I want to do this afternoon, in other words, is not to judge the Arab world as somehow peculiar or deficient, but to understand some of its history, and to understand that this history itself is bound up with a long history of Western intervention that has unquestionably shaped the region, both positively and negatively, since at least Napoleon's invasion of Egypt in 1798, and certainly, most recently, with the US invasion and occupation of Iraq in 2003. We may indeed be horrified by the violent mobilizations across sectarian lines and the quasi-genocidal extremism that appears in such organizations such as ISIS that are doing so much to disfigure the region and the Levant. But we should also understand that Arabs themselves and people in the Middle East themselves have been far more horrified by the unraveling of their societies. The idea of sectarianism, in other words, has haunted the modern imagination of the Arab world in much the same way as the idea of racism haunts and has haunted the modern imagination of the United States. This is not because sectarianism itself, as I said, is age-old or free-floating, but that much like racism in the contemporary United States, sectarianism is a diagnosis that makes most sense when thought about in relationship to its ideological antithesis. In other words, in clear language, I hope, to identify and condemn racism in America, in other words, one presumably must uphold an idea or have an idea of equality and emancipation. And so too, to identify and condemn sectarianism in the Arab world, one presumably has to uphold an idea of ecumenism and equality between Muslim and non-Muslim, or among Muslims themselves. There is no history of sectarianism, in other words, that is not also and obviously a history of pluralism at the same time. And I'll explain what I mean. Where then to begin the story of sectarianism, understanding sectarianism in the modern Middle East? As I was thinking about this talk and grappling with what I see as a pervasive medievalization of the violence in the Middle East, where people always take us back to the medieval world rather than focus on the contemporary world, in both the United States and, in fact, in the Arab world's media, I am returned once again to the importance of the 19th century as a point of departure for any meaningful discussion of contemporary sectarian problems in the region. And I say this principally for two reasons. First, because the breakdown in the 19th century of a long-standing Ottoman imperial system that had ruled for centuries over a vast multi-religious, multi-ethnic, and multilinguistic landscape opened ideological and political space for new political imaginations, new political vocabularies, new political horizons, some of which were more inclusive and some far less so. The Ottomans, as many of you know, conquered Constantinople in 1453. They also conquered Damascus, Jerusalem, Mecca, Cairo in 1516 and 1517, and ruled these areas until the fall of the empire as a result of the First World War. And yet, sectarian violence between Muslim and Christian Ottomans occurred primarily in the 19th century, and that between Arabs and Jews occurred mainly in the 20th century, and that between Sunni and Shia is unfolding before our eyes in the 21st century. And so again, the idea is, let's start in the 19th century and move forward to explain what the relationship is between sectarian violence and notions of nationalism and discourses of equality. The second, and frankly more important reason why I begin in the 19th century is that I think the advent of the problem of sectarianism should be thought of, and we should think of seriously, as an expression of a global 19th century that introduced notions such as nationalism, citizenship, political equality, irrespective of religious affiliation, into many different parts of the world. My point is that many states and polities in the 19th century struggled profoundly with new ideas of secular equality and tried to reconcile these, or had to struggle with these ideas and reconcile them with long-standing convictions in religious and or racial difference. To put this point in the simplest possible terms, and even, I admit, crude terms, at the same time as the United States struggled with slavery and black emancipation, and Europe with the emancipation of Jews and the question of anti-Semitism, the Ottoman Empire was confronted with, in the mid-19th century, the question of the place of non-Muslims in what had long been an Islamic empire. To the extent, and the problems of sectarianism in the Ottoman Empire between Muslim and Christian, as I said, are specific to the mid-19th century, especially when we're talking about Ottoman Syria and the Ottoman Levant, the part of the Ottoman Empire I'm most concerned with. To the extent that we can speak about the DNA of modern sectarianism, it does, I think, surely lie in the fact that the Ottoman Empire had been, for centuries, what sociologist Karen Barkey has described as, quote, an empire of difference. That is to say, the precept of the ruling house of the Ottoman Empire, the house of Osman, the ruling dynasty, was to encourage, to regulate, to maintain an extraordinary patchwork of highly different and highly differentiated ethnic, linguistic, and religious communities that coexisted and conflicted across the empire. The so-called millet system reinforced the emphasis on religion in a profoundly unequal, and that's the point I want to emphasize, you have coexistence and inequality, political and social system. At the top of this empire of difference sat the shadow of God on earth, that is to say the Sultan, whose rule was legitimated by a supposed upholding of Islam, his defense of the realm against infidels, and a stamping out of heresy within the realm. What matters for our story is that the Ottoman Muslim rule or Ottoman Muslim supremacy was deeply imbued within the ideological, political, and legal terrain of the empire. The Sultan was also theoretically committed to maintaining order among and the tranquility of all his disempowered and disenfranchised imperial subjects, including, of course, Christian and Jewish dhimmis, people of the book. The point that needs to be made about this Ottoman system is not, up until the 19th century, is not that it was tolerant or intolerant, because toleration, after all, was but one of several imperial strategies that included coercion. Rather, the point that needs to be made over and over again is that the empire witnessed centuries of coexistence in which different Muslim and Christian and Jewish communities and the ecclesiastical leaderships of different communities accepted the fact that they were bound to live side by side, to literally coexist for the foreseeable future. That's what we could describe as the classical Ottoman age. What then is the difference between this classical age and the 19th century? What's the difference between the pre-19th century Ottoman rule and what I would describe as the advent of a 19th century politics of modern sectarianism? And there are three factors interconnected. The first is the rise of ethno-religious nationalism, especially in the Balkans, that fundamentally challenged Ottoman Muslim supremacy militarily, geographically, politically, and ideologically. The second related factor is the rise of sustained Western imperialism, imperial rivalries, and so-called imperial humanitarianism. And the third, both of these in turn precipitated a third factor, an Ottoman Reformation that changed the logic and definition of the empire from being an empire of difference, where you had coexistence and inequality, to becoming paradoxically, attempting to become paradoxically an empire of citizens, which is sort of course, a contradiction in terms, an empire of citizens where non-discrimination became the ruling mantra of the empire. And this was a massive transformation in the mid-19th century empire. And so for the first time in the history of any Muslim state, in 1839 and then again in 1856, the Ottoman state implicitly accepted a revolutionary political equality of Muslim and non-Muslim subjects. They declared this equality more explicitly in 1856, and finally they announced it constitutionally in 1876. The jizya, or the poll tax on non-Muslims that ISIS has re-established in parts of Iraq today, was abolished by the Ottoman state in 1855. A concept of secular Ottoman citizenship was introduced in 1869. And the Ottoman purpose in this massive transformation, again, this reordering, this ideological and political legal reordering of the empire, or the Tanzimat, was clear. It was to stave off further European intervention and to consolidate Ottoman imperial power. But within the empire, this amazing transformation, this legal shift from discrimination to non-discrimination, was, in some quarters at least, massively controversial. And in several parts of the empire, especially in Ottoman Syria, the formal emancipation of non-Muslims was met, at least in some places, with unease and dismay. And in some instances, infamously, with sectarian violence, unprecedented sectarian violence against Christians. In Aleppo in 1850, an anti-conscription protest degenerated into a massacre of Christians and the looting of the Christian quarter of the city. This is 1850. Several churches were burned and hundreds of Christian homes were ransacked. In Damascus, a decade later in 1860, a mob turned on Christians of the city in July of that year. The unprecedented massacres of Christians in Aleppo and Damascus coincided with a civil war in so-called civil war in neighboring Mount Lebanon between Maronite Christians and Druze, a sect that lives in Lebanon and Syria and parts of Israel and Palestine today. A war which also ended in 1860 in the utter defeat and massacre of Maronite Christians. So, just like today, so we're talking about massacres of Christians that took place in the mid-19th century. Just like today, the Western press at the time insisted that the civilized world was witnessing a spectacle of age-old Muslim Oriental fanaticism and sectarianism in an ostensibly uncivilized part of the world. But the descriptions of inherent fanaticism or age-old sectarianism hardly explain why Damascus was the scene of a massacre in 1860, as opposed to, say, 1800 or 1900. Why the sectarian episodes occurred in Aleppo and Damascus at a particular point and not others. That Muslims and Christians were involved is obvious. But the riots or the violence that took place in, and of course I want us to think about what's happening today as well, the riots that took place in 1850 and 1860 were not about Islam or Christianity. They had nothing to do with the origins of Islam or with the Quran, just like today's sectarian or so-called sectarian battles have almost nothing to do with an original Shi'i schism or Sunni Shi'i schism. Instead, these events in the mid-19th century pointed to a very specific 19th century moment that witnessed, as I said, three things happening simultaneously. The first was a sudden, top-down disestablishment of a system of symbolic and legal Muslim supremacy without any cultural preparation on the part of the Ottoman Muslim elites, whose empire was under enormous European military, political, and economic pressure. So that's one factor. The second factor was the reality of Western imperialism that claimed to protect Christians in the Orient who were themselves increasingly associated, and some of whom associated themselves with Europe. The third was the agency of some local Christians and Muslims who adopted a far more strident perspective on their newfound rights in a rapidly changing imperial landscape. In other words, that some Muslim inhabitants in cities such as Damascus felt that they as Muslims were entitled to a privileged relationship to the state that had long justified itself as a Muslim state is not and should not be surprising. This dismay at reform is not, if we think about it, so different from how many Europeans today feel about Muslims in Europe, or in a far more structurally oppressive manner, how many white Americans fought bitterly against civil rights for African Americans. Equality, in other words, is not simply a virtue or a right. It is often felt to be an acute and painful concession. This feeling of resentment was compounded, of course, by the rise of Western imperialism in the Ottoman Empire that I mentioned, so that it became impossible to separate emancipation of Christians from Western imperialism. The more the Ottomans tried to secularize their state, the more the European powers, Britain and France and Russia primarily, intervened as Christian powers with a duty to protect what they saw as the oppressed Christians of the empire. So, to make a long story short, these European interventions made it clear that as far as civilized, quote-unquote, Europe was concerned, the reformation of the Ottoman Empire had to be based on at least two points. The first point was that there had to be a sectarian political framework that to resolve what were taken by European powers to be endemic sectarian hatreds in the region. The second was that Muslim rule had to be disestablished for a modern regime of toleration to be established in the East. In other words, European powers refused to believe that a secular Ottomanism was a viable project in the sense that a secular Americanism or a secular Englishness or a secular Frenchness was. And secondly, these European powers believed, who of course had enormous influence in this region, that believed that any reformed Ottoman Empire needed constant European supervision. So the British consul in Erzurum in Anatolia in 1856, James Brandt, admitted frankly that a reformed Turkey had to be maintained as an independent country because of the balance of power within Europe, the so-called Eastern question. He noted as well that, quote, her positive independence will have to be placed in abeyance until she has learned to administer her own government on an enlightened and equitable system. The upshot was that following the massacres of 1860, the Ottomans and the Europeans hammered out a series of political compromises that institutionalized for the first time, as far as I'm aware, sectarian political structures across the empire as a sign of an Ottoman commitment to non-discrimination. So in other words, the sectarian quota systems that are today being placed in Iraq, the origins of these kinds of systems were first tried out in places such as Mount Lebanon, Bosnia, Crete. In other words, any part of the empire where the Europeans felt that they had an interest and where there was a Christian population that had to be protected. The first Ottoman national elections, or parliamentary elections, were held in 1877, also effectively adopted a sectarian quota approach, informally at least. Such sectarian forms of political representation, in other words, dividing positions or allocations on the basis of religious affiliation, were manifestly not democratic. The inhabitants of Mount Lebanon, for example, were never consulted in the creation of a sectarian system that was created in Mount Lebanon in 1861. They were also deeply insidious because they entrenched and reified the idea that people could only be communal or sectarian. They naturalized the idea and politicized the idea of religious difference. They were, moreover, very different from how the United States, for example, resolved, or at least began to resolve, its massive racial crisis and bloody civil war. In other words, in the US after the Civil War, the idea was not to create a quota system for African Americans. The idea was that everyone is equal and everyone has the same secular rights of emancipation. In the Ottoman case, what happened, the British and the French came in and said, no, Christians deserve this many seats, X deserve that many seats, everyone has to have seats based on their religious affiliation. In other words, undercutting the notion of a secular Ottoman identity. Now, that these sectarian arrangements that were put in place in the Ottoman Empire were not democratic, it seems to me, were obvious. It's always the elites who choose, and the Europeans and the Ottomans who then approve. But recall the alternatives. As undemocratic as the sectarian system was, and as negative as it was in terms of reifying religious affiliation, recall the alternatives that were in place in the 19th century. On the one hand, you had the Imperial Ottoman State, which had long been a Muslim state that discriminated against non-Muslims, and that's no longer a viable alternative. On the other hand, there was the Balkan model, the European national model, the ethno-religious model, in other words, where you basically say the state belongs only to one group who will be equal citizens and everyone else should leave through ethnic cleansing or through various pressures, so that Muslims, for example, don't belong in the Balkans, they belong outside of the Balkans. Ethno-religious nationalism, in other words, indicated a fundamentally different form of modern political order that suggests than that suggested by sectarian political arrangements. So on the one hand, sectarian political arrangements reify religious affiliation, but at least they keep everyone, in theory, in the same political frame, as opposed to ethno-religious nationalism, which makes the state the concern of one particular community. And everyone who doesn't fit is a minority who has to be tolerated or expelled. And these are two very different ways of thinking about how to organize a political society. The point is that the sectarian experiments that were put in place in the Ottoman Empire in the mid-19th century and late 19th century were stopgap measures that failed to resolve a far greater problem of the spread of nationalism and European imperialism that increasingly stripped the empire of ever more territory, resources, and population. In regions like Greece, the political imagination of the new state of Greece in the 19th century explicitly excluded Muslims. This was the same in Serbia, in Crete, and in Bulgaria between 1876 and 1913. Over 2 million Muslims were forced out of Europe and the Caucasus in the 1860s and 1870s. There was a massive population shift in the 19th century. And this is a map, take this with a grain of salt because it's by a propagandist, but the idea of this map shows you the kinds of massive population shifts that took place in the late 19th century in the Balkans and in Anatolia. So basically Muslims were being forced out of Ottoman Europe, or what used to be Ottoman Europe, as these new Balkan states came into being. And the Treaty of Berlin in 1878, for instance, stripped away 4.5 million, mostly Christian subjects from the empire and also ceded 8% of its most fertile territory. And so what happened as these population shifts occurred, the remnants of the Ottoman Empire by the turn of the 20th century, certainly by 1913, was a much more Muslim empire than it had been in the mid-19th century. So the Muslim share of the total population of the Ottoman Empire went from 60% before 1878 to 74% by 1907 to 85% by 1913, all as a result of these massive wars, ethnic cleansing, population exchanges that took place in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. In the aftermath of these catastrophic wars, Ottoman Turkish leaders became increasingly determined to create a modern militarized nation state that they presumed would be essentially Muslim in order to be viable. It should come as no surprise that it's in this era that the Armenian question emerged as a political question, and that it's in this era that leads eventually to the Armenian genocide. So in other words, as the Ottoman state lost more and more territory in the Balkans, it was determined to rid itself of what it now considered to be an considered an untrustworthy Christian minority, the Armenians, in Anatolia, that the Ottomans viewed as a proxy for Russia. And that had no place in necessarily in Ottoman eyes, overwhelmingly Muslim, modern Turkish Ottoman state. And that's why, of course, the genocide takes place in 1915 and not in 1815 and not in 1715 and not in 1615. So an empire of multi-religious subjects was well on its way to becoming a state of Muslim citizens. Now, what's this got to do with ISIS? This is what it has to do with ISIS. The irony is that while all this is happening in the northern part of the empire, so what is today the Balkans, Anatolia, Turkey, in the Levant, where ISIS today flourishes, in other words, in the Arabic-speaking, predominantly Arabic-speaking Levant, the Mashriq, the Arab East, or the region that today encompasses, roughly speaking, Lebanon, Syria, Israel, the Palestinian territories, and depending on how broad we want to be, Egypt and Iraq, the region that had witnessed the Damascus and Aleppo massacres in the mid-19th century was largely spared from after 1860 all the way until the end of the Ottoman Empire. This region, the Arab Levant, was largely spared the tribulations of ethno-religious nationalism, border-making, nation-state formation, and ethnic cleansing in the final decades of the Ottoman Empire. In other words, the extraordinary irony is at the same time as the Armenians were facing a catastrophic alienation from the Ottoman state leading to a genocide eventually in 1915, that same moment, Arab Christians were involved in what Arab historians think of as the Nahda or the Renaissance of Arab thought. So Arab Christians were experiencing the belle époque, the height of their sort of cultural influence in contemporary modern history. So you had an extraordinary bifurcation of this empire. The northern part was racked by nationalism and ethnic cleansing and border making. The southern part, the Levant, was this place where you had Arabic-speaking Muslims, Christians, and Jews who were defining new forms of coexistence on the basis of equality of male citizens. Arabic-speaking Christian and Jewish individuals, in fact, played, as I said, a major role in elaborating, especially the Christian Arabs, in elaborating an ecumenical Syrian, Egyptian, Arab, and Ottoman affiliations in this moment. For the first time, people thinking themselves as Arabs, as a Muslim and Christian Arab, and as a Jewish Arab, as equals. This was the first time in history this was happening in a political sense as equals. There was no militant Arab nationalism to speak of. There was no major Arab Christian separatist movement to speak of. There was, however, a common Arabic language. And as I said, many Arab Christians and Jews played a well-known role in the so-called Nahda or Renaissance of Arabic thought in the second half of the 19th century. And so it was no surprise that Arab Christians like this man, Butros al-Bustani, who was scarred by the violence of 1860, opened up the first ecumenical school in the Ottoman Empire after the 1860 massacres, and was committed to the idea of creating a society where Muslim and Christian Arabic-speaking Syrians could not just live, but thrive as equal subjects of a reforming, non-discriminatory Ottoman state. So far from being inevitable, it was in the 19th century, and in this 19th century moment, late 19th century moment, that the idea of a multi-religious Syrian, Egyptian, or Arab nation became comprehensible and thus meaningful for the first time. I don't want to romanticize this moment. I don't want to say that everything was perfect in the Arab provinces, or what we call the Arab provinces of the Ottoman Empire, because there were obviously far less ecumenical strains of thought, and indeed many paradoxes, silences, and taboos, especially in the realm of gender and personal status laws, at the heart of Nahda discourse. Nevertheless, I don't think we have appreciated how quickly, in the decades after 1860, the equality of Muslim and non-Muslim male citizens in Syria, Palestine, and Egypt became relatively uncontroversial. In other words, the shift from a system of Islamic supremacy to a system of equality was relatively uncontroversial in the Arab provinces after 1860. The ideas of outright secularism or the liberation of women were in fact far more controversial than political equality between male citizens in the empire. Perhaps most important for us to consider, this Nahda commitment to pluralism was far more able and willing to handle the question of equality of male subjects after centuries of discrimination than, for instance, the Anglo-Saxon US Empire or the British Empire, in which the idea of racial equality was largely unthinkable, even into the 20th century. So the idea of saying that these people are somehow backwards or that these people are destined to have sectarian violence simply ignores this extraordinary 19th century history. And yet, and I want to conclude here, because we enter into the colonial era, the post-Ottoman era. In these same Arab provinces, of course, ISIS today thrives in these exact same areas that in the 19th century, late 19th and early 20th century, witnessed such extraordinary developments in intellectual and ideological culture. Yet in these same Arab provinces, the problem of sectarianism was to be greatly exacerbated in the 20th century, following the deliberate dismantling of the empire and the advent of direct European colonial rule. And this brings me, finally, to the enormous and undeniable role that Western powers, particularly Great Britain and France after First World War, have played in creating a fundamentally new terrain in the post-Ottoman Middle East. Once again, my point is that the sectarian conflicts of the post-Ottoman age do not indicate sectarian hatreds as much as specific conditions, decisions, policies that induce certain outcomes. And I'll explain what I mean. The problem is not, in other words, Sykes-Picot as such. It's not simply the artificial division of the region into various states. I mean, because after all states, in a sense, are artificial. But the manner in which these states were coercively created along new and often quite deliberate sectarian lines in the name of safeguarding religious freedom, but under colonial conditions. So France, for instance, creates Lebanon, a Maronite-dominated entity that developed the region's most explicit and, of course, until today, most ambivalent form of sectarian governance. So until today, Lebanon has this sectarian system of governance. France further partitioned Syria following the establishment of its mandate into Alawite, Druze, and Arab states based on religion and ethnicity. And there was nothing, and I want to emphasize this point, there's nothing natural about these states any more than it would be natural to divide Texas, where I teach today, into separate Latino, African American, and white states. You could do it. There is diversity. You could do it that way. But there is a specific rationale as to why the French did it. Western imperialism, of course, was not monolithic, nor were its sectarian effects the same. The paradox of Western colonial rule was this. It deconstructed an Ottoman whole into various sectarian parts at the same time as it tried to build up viable polities in a manner that safeguarded imperial hegemony. As much as Western imperialism invented the category of the so-called moderate Arab, it also gave these Arabs an opportunity to share in the elaboration of colonial rule. The creation of the Hashemite state of Iraq is one example of this. Western colonial rule, nevertheless, also systematically fanned fears and dependency of what for the first time were described as minorities across this region. And at the same time, perversely, they created entirely new Western powers, Britain and France, created new Islamic institutions to prove their respect for the region's Arab-Muslim majority. So the British, for example, in Palestine, which they take as a mandate, create the so-called Supreme Muslim Council. The French elevate the Mufti of Beirut into a representative of all of Lebanon's Sunni Muslims. Both France and Britain further elaborated Ottoman-era sectarian personal status laws. Perhaps most obvious and most tragic, British colonialism in Palestine oversaw the emergence of an entirely new conflict in this period, in the post-World War I period. That is to say, when they encouraged and enabled political Zionism to transform the multi-religious land of Palestine into an exclusively Jewish state. The nationalisms that would develop in the interwar period in Lebanon and Syria and Iraq could, in principle at least, be reconciled to a Nahda ethos that developed in the late Ottoman Empire, in the Levant. In other words, they struggled, Lebanese nationalism, Syrian nationalism, Iraqi nationalism, struggled profoundly with the question of how to reconcile diversity with nationalism. And there were all these taboos and there were contradictions as these nationalisms developed in the interwar period. But they were quite different, it seems to me, from the exclusive ethno-religious nationalism of Zionism in Palestine that was fundamentally a different form of nationalism that germinated not in Ottoman soil or in Ottoman history, but in Europe and was exported to the Middle East. It's surely significant, after all, that the main Zionist ideologues of the time almost all came from Europe and America and not from the ancient Jewish communities of the Arab region. It is surely significant that the term Arab and Jew became antonyms, oppositional in this period for the first time. It's also significant that the opposition to the Balfour Declaration and the Zionist representation at the Paris Peace Conference was initially led by so-called Muslim Christian associations, which criticized not only the Jewish claim to Palestine, but decried the regression that an exclusive religious nationalism represented for a region that had religious diversity. It is significant that the first major intercommunal Jewish-Arab riots occurred in the Mandate period. And yet, of course, people often think of the Arab-Israeli conflict as an ancient Arab-Jewish conflict that goes back, supposedly, to ancient times. Yet, of course, that's simply not the case. The Nakba of 1948, during which Palestinian Muslims and Christians were expelled en masse from their homes and lands, destroyed the Nahda ethos in Palestine and brought to an end one of the most interesting and intellectually open and optimistic eras in the history of the Levant. We should recall that before the ISIS expulsion of Christians from Mosul earlier this last year, the largest single mass expulsion of Christians in the Arab world occurred in 1948, when Palestinian Christians, along with their Muslim Palestinians, were forced from their homes in order to create a Jewish state. The resulting Arab-Israeli conflict, moreover, severely compromised the Nahda ethos elsewhere by accelerating a xenophobic nationalism across the region, putting enormous strain and pressure on Jewish communities who were often scapegoated as a result of what occurred in Palestine. The evictions of hundreds of thousands of Muslims and Christian Palestinian Arabs and the destruction of Jewish communities in the Arab world, in other words, represent two sides of the same coin, and in a sense, the end or a shattering blow to the Nahda ethos. The loss of a multi-religious Palestine was a terrible blow. The loss of Jewish life in the Arab world and the bifurcation of the idea of being Arab and being Jewish compounded the defeat of Nahda ecumenical culture. And both losses, of course, still haunt the Arab world until today. There is no end to the story of sectarianism in the modern Middle East, even though I suggested this afternoon that there is a 19th century beginning. For this reason, I have not spoken, and I end here honestly, about the current and looming wars between Sunni and Shi'i in the Arab world, whether in Iraq and Syria and Bahrain and Saudi Arabia or in Lebanon. One reason I don't talk about these conflicts is that they're far more recent. They're happening, you know, before our very eyes, and I'm not in any position to tell you about what is happening because none of us really know what is taking place. But what's amazing to me is just like the Arab-Israeli conflict, the so-called Arab-Jewish conflict, and just like 19th century Muslim-non-Muslim conflicts, what's happening today is being represented as an age-old, ancient struggle that's just showing its latest face. But just like those other two conflicts, between Muslim and non-Muslim in the 19th century, Arab and Jewish in the 20th century, what's happening today is absolutely rooted in the contemporary politics of today. Given how little we really know about what is going on in Syria and Iraq, who is behind ISIS, who funds these networks, what is the role of various intelligence agencies, whether Arab or non-Arab, American, Iranian, or whatever? What is the role of various volunteers? How do these things work? We know so little about what is going on today. It seems to me there is little to be lost in using the history that we have uncovered about the 19th century and early 20th century to reflect sensibly about what is going on today in the region. My point, finally, is first and foremost to remind us of the degree to which we have inherited a Middle East and an Arab world that has been unmade just as much as it has been made. And it's this point, I think, that we often forget. And it's this point that we have to always bear in mind when we think about what is going on today. Thank you.
Okay, we usually have a discussant for our invited lectures, but given the lecture that we just heard, I'm glad that we sort of don't have a discussant so we can give the audience as much time to sort of pepper you with questions. I have my own set of sort of questions that I'd like to ask you, but I want to give the audience the first opportunity to pose questions, and then we'll go for about half an hour and then end it. So the floor is open. If you have any questions, I'll do my best to recognize your hands as I see them. Jettisoned in the air, projected in the air. Yes, go ahead.
I'd like to ask you how you think this is playing out. You said you don't really know, you don't really know, and you're kind of learning as you go along. I'm curious in the history that's been there, in the history that's proceeding, whether this is going to be a generational kind of thing, or whether it's going to be more short-lived based upon wins and losses.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's a good question, but it's a question that I can't possibly answer in the sense that, as you said, it really depends on what happens on the so-called battlefield. And it also depends on the role of external powers. It also depends on the role of internal sort of actors and at what point they decide that the current political terrain is one that they can live with and so on and so forth. There's so many variables that I can't possibly answer and tell you what is going to happen. But my point is to say what is happening is not a reflection, and that's the principal point. Again, it's not a reflection of some kind of eternal Sunni-Shi'i schism. That's the point, I think, the principal point. That's the most misleading point, because that's the point that people say as a way of saying it's not our responsibility. It's their problem. They've always been like this. They always will be like this. And we have nothing to do with this, which is simply not the case. And I think that's the point. And that's why I say the role of external powers in the formation and the history of the modern Middle East is absolutely essential. It doesn't mean that the West is to blame for everything, but it means you can't talk about the modern Middle East without also talking about recognizing and acknowledging Western, multifaceted Western intervention in the region. No, I mean, are you talking about the 19th century or today, or both? Both. I mean, obviously they're crucial. I did mention very briefly, probably far too hastily, that there's two points to be made to answer your question about the 19th century. One is that I tried to allude in the talk to the, for example, the sectarian riots that take place in Aleppo in 1850. They actually begin as an anti-conscription riot by lower-class Muslims, so-called lower class. This is, of course, these are all the description of historians who say lower class Muslims who were actually initially rebelling against Ottoman rule and against Muslim, upper class Muslims because of onerous taxations, because of conscription. And then as they all the rich, the notables in Aleppo flee to the citadel, what happens then is that as these rioters are moving through the Christian quarter, they start looting the Christian quarter. And then it's transformed into in the historiography, it's transformed into a sectarian riot. But what's amazing is that the class dimensions of that riot are either ignored or downplayed or mentioned, and then they go on to describe it still as a sectarian thing, as if the religious component is the most important. The point, of course, is not to say it's not important, but to relate, as you say, exactly, to relate the struggle between class, economics, culture, religion, these are all going together. They all inform each other. And I think it's impossible to disaggregate and say one is the only cause or one is not. But to your other question, there were obviously many divisions within the Ottoman Empire that are not just religious divisions. You also have, you mentioned 1848. I mean, there are different kinds of, what kind of state do we want to have? Is it going to be a state which is more or less liberal? Is it going to be more or less militarist? Is it going to be more or less nationalist, and so on and so forth? There are all these other questions that were also equally important in the 19th century. But far and away, it seems to me, the most overlooked yet obvious point, unlike 1848, or maybe in a sense like 1848 revolutions, is the extraordinary presence of Europe in the elaboration of the 19th century Ottoman Empire, then of course in the direct creation of the post-Ottoman Middle East. And then of course after 1945, the role of the United States, especially with the oil economy and the petroleum order in the region, all of these play a huge role in sort of the unfolding of what we see today. So,
yes.
In the Levant.
Yeah.
Do I see a future resolution? Again, we go back. I can't. Ideally, yes. I mean, ideally, the point about Israel, what's interesting about Israel, leave aside the idea of whether one likes or doesn't like the question of Zionism or not, but what's interesting is the idea of creating a state, unlike all the other states that are, I mean, they're all artificial states, they're all being created at this time. The idea of saying that this is going to be a Jewish state, a state for one group of people, and the diversity that already exists there has to be removed and then reconstituted, subordinate to the idea of a Jewish state, had enormous problems, and it was an enormously violent project for those, of course, who are the victims of Zionism, the Palestinians first and foremost, but not just Palestinians. To the very idea of the idea of Arab Jews, for instance, which was a creation of the Nahda period, which was something that was happening in this late 19th, early 20th century, and then that becomes basically one of the principal sort of casualties, it seems to me, of the Arab-Israeli conflict is the idea of being Arab and Jewish, where they, as I said, they become in this period antonyms. They become oppositional. So, and of course, let alone the huge effect of refugees, we go back to economics, the huge role of what happens when you have hundreds of thousands of people who are dispersed, who put enormous pressure, the idea of the defeat of these states and what happens and the pressures they're in. And all these things, of course, and the militarization of the region, of the Levant in particular, these play an enormous role in the making and unmaking. And so presumably a resolution would help. But Israel is one aspect of it. I mentioned it because that's the one, that's the existential crisis that the Arabs had evaded in the 19th century, but came to haunt them in the 20th century. Whereas in the 19th century, it's the Balkan nationalisms and Turkey and the Armenians who had faced these kinds of questions. And in the case of the Arabs, it's Zionism that's the first major, massive existential crisis that they deal with. But it's not the only one, of course. I mean, there's Saudi Wahhabism. There is the extraordinary petroleum wealth of Saudi Arabia, which also plays a huge role. And, of course, there's the U.S. architecture of hegemony in the region as well. Well, I mean, your question, I think it's an interesting question insofar as you've almost answered your own question. And you've almost answered your own question.
How
in this.
Much Western, how much intrinsic?
Yeah.
At this point, where those intrinsic factors are so locked in, where I think Western powers almost feel confused, overwhelmed, and helpless.
Yeah, but
wish to stoke some of those.
Yes. Yeah, what I would say, okay, I think that's a very important question at two levels. What I would say is that the idea of trying to, after the 19th century, trying to disentangle the so-called Western from what you're referring to as the intrinsic or internal or endemic or indigenous, whatever word you want to use, I think is a futile question. I think it's very difficult for us to talk about Saudi Arabia or Iran without talking at some level, without acknowledging at least, right? Yeah. No, it can't. It's not. So it's not. I agree. There are, of course, if you're going to call it local traditions or histories that predate Western imperialism. That's why in the book that I'm writing, I specifically talk about the 19th century and Aleppo and Damascus, because it's not, you can't say it's Western colonialism as such. I mean, there are these questions of discrimination and non-discrimination that clearly predate Western imperialism, but I wouldn't say, and I wouldn't describe them as an age-old conflict that's burning, or that the embers are there. I think that's where the great disagreement I have. It's not that there's this conflict, because you could also make the exact opposite argument and say, well, there's also been centuries of coexistence. I mean, you've had Sunnis and Shias living side by side for centuries, in fact, in many instances, intermarried. Not always, but in some instances, why don't we focus on that and say that's the history that we should focus on, just as much as we focus on the tensions and discrimination and discriminatory attitudes and so on that you're referring to. You see, I could say, you could point to both. And my point is, rather than romanticizing one or overemphasizing the other, I would say, let's look at a particular historical moment and look at how various factors will play on, will invent, will create, will, you say, stoke the embers of a various conflict. Fair enough, but I just don't, my point is to move us away from this notion that there's this perpetual conflict, because it's not a perpetual conflict. It is a particular conflict. Some people are seeking security. Others are not. I mean, that's my point. I mean, in other words, ISIS does not represent, by any stretch of the imagination, all of Sunni Muslims. I mean, ISIS represents, to me, it's an aberration. We don't know anything about, really, honestly, about, and so the idea that ISIS becomes the representative of Sunni Islam is deeply problematic for obvious reasons. But the idea of saying, I mean, I would agree that people do seek at certain moments refuge in group identities. I mean, Zionism is obviously a great example as well. I mean, these things happen, but you can't say that Zionism, therefore, is Judaism. And as you see what I'm saying, I mean, these are the issues that I'm trying to highlight, to say that we have to be so attentive to the particular, because that's the only antidote to this discourse of an age-old struggle between X and Y. Because I think people in the region will themselves do it, because there already is a history, precisely because there is this ecumenical history that I've tried to evoke, not clearly perhaps tonight, this afternoon, but there is a profound and powerful ecumenical history, not just of Muslim, Christian, or Arab, Jewish, but also of Sunni, Shi'i, coexistence, if that's the word we want to use, that is a reality, that is a historical reality, and that can, just as in the 1930s and 1940s and 1950s and 1960s and 1970s, people lived together despite all sorts of confessional and sectarian differences, they may do so again. So the idea of saying the knot that we see today is precisely because there's been a history, in other words, it gives you hope that things will change. How? I can't tell you, because we don't know the various conditions that are going to go into unmaking the knot, the sectarian knot. But if your point is that people profoundly believe in the knot, right, or in these identities at this moment, I think that's undeniable. There's no question that there is tremendous mobilization. But you see, if you read the Saudi media, the Saudi-owned media, which is the vast majority of the Arab media, is owned either by the Saudis or the Qataris. If you read this media, it's extraordinary how sectarian much of it is. And that plays a role as well. It's not, again, these are not natural things. These are produced and therefore can be changed. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying they got along pretty well. I'm saying there's a history of coexistence, by which I mean people accepted the fact, different, not just Sunni and Shia, of course. You have, you know, any number of groups and communities and nationalities or ethnicities, groups, that the communities that lived and accepted the fact that they were bound to live side by side for the foreseeable future. That's my point about coexistence. Not that it's they get along in kind of an easy, liberal way, but that they accept the fact that they're bound to live side by side with others who don't share their faith. Does that make sense? And that is the political frame in which they operate. Yes, I hope so. At least. That about the history of coexistence? Yeah, I mean, there are books, and I'm happy to sort of, I'll tell you afterwards about some books. The question is, are there books that do it without romanticizing? The idea is to talk about coexistence without romanticizing it and saying it's perfect, or that there's no such thing as sectarian tension, because that's manifestly not the case. But the point to make over and over again, it's just like the United States, just like every other society that I know, but especially since I live here and I teach in Texas and in Houston, and you see these things day in, day out. You see what's happening in Baltimore, you see what's happening in Ferguson. This is every country with any kind of diversity is challenged by the idea and the question of diversity, especially in the modern world where the question of citizenship and equality come into play. Because if there's no citizenship and there's no equality, well, then diversity can be, like in the Ottoman case, regulated insofar as there's only one person with sovereign power, the Sultan, and everyone else is subordinate to him. In the modern period where you're talking about equality and access to resources and so on, that this becomes diversity becomes a much more difficult issue to deal with. And the Ottoman and the post-Ottoman Middle East, as I said, are not exceptional in that regard. But yes, I'm happy to refer to some books. It's part of the story. You're absolutely right. It's part of the story. I wouldn't call it ethnic Turks splitting from Arabs, because that's almost too nationalist a reading, a retrospective reading, because it wasn't quite like that, because there were several Arabs who actually were part of the Young Turk movement. There were many people who were committed to the CUP. There were many people who were, in fact, the vast majority of Arabs were loyal to the empire until the end. And the uprising that takes place in Hejaz, Sharif Hussein and Faisal, of course, with British encouragement. I mean, it's a rebellion that hardly, it wasn't a popular rebellion against Ottoman rule. So it's important not to overstate the difference. But there's no question that by the end of the empire, especially after 1913, the CUP, the Young Turks, so-called, basically the leadership, the very top leadership, had clearly was thinking of the empire in nationalist and Muslim terms. And the Arabs were basically, there was a question that was looming, but it wasn't. I don't think it was at the point of breakdown yet, by 1915 or 1916.
Sectarian tensions, and then in some cases violence.
It's something I'm thinking about, honestly. So I'll give you a provisional answer, because it was a provisional point. But the answer is, the question. I've been thinking about this a lot. When the Ottoman state, under enormous European pressure, first in 1839, then in 1856. And then finally in 1876, each of those points, of course, coincides with a massive crisis for the Ottoman state when it was close to, 1839, you had Muhammad Ali of Egypt, who was threatening to overthrow the Sultanate. 1856 is the Crimean War. 1876, of course, 1877 is the Ottoman-Russian War and the Balkan crises. In each of these moments, under enormous European pressure, the Ottomans issue an edict of what I would call an emancipation edict, in essence, saying that non-Muslims and Muslims are equal in the eyes of the Sultan. And non-discrimination, it becomes the mantra of the... But to say this, especially 1839 and 1850, to say this without any culture, to go from that as a top-down decree, without any kind of... it's not that there was no school system, per se. There was no... when I say cultural preparation, it really does come out of the blue.
Right.
A radical break with tradition without any kind of, literally, as I said, preparation. It's literally an imperial edict. And that took time to work itself out. What I find most remarkable is that despite the lack of cultural preparation, and precisely because of the history of coexistence that wasn't liberal, but was a reality, what's remarkable about the period after 1860 in the Arab Levant, between 1860 and World War I and through World War I, and in fact all the way until recently, of how quickly, relatively speaking, the idea of equality between Muslim and non-Muslim male subjects and citizens became hegemonic and uncontested. That's what's remarkable, especially if you consider, again, African Americans in the United States. Obviously, there's no slavery in the same way there as there was here. It's not the same that, non-Muslims didn't, of course, occupy the same social or economic position of oppression that African Americans faced in this country. But if you think about how difficult in this country the transition was, or in Europe with the idea of equality with colonies, with the colonial world, I think it's a remarkable sort of thing that we should bear in mind. That's my
and also potentially optimistic. So
yeah, of course that these are not barbarians. We're talking about people who have a cultural heritage that they can draw on, and to reformulate their worlds.
Well, Ussama, the title of your talk was partially helping us to understand the Middle East Gordian knot, and I think based on your lecture, you thought you made a major headway in terms of sort of helping us unpack some of the historical background that explains the contemporary problems in the Middle East, particularly with respect to sectarianism. And so I want to thank you on behalf of the Center for Middle East Studies and the Joseph Corbell School for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.